Welcome. We are so thrilled you joined us today. This is Fast Forward's Demo Day. I'm Shannon Farley.
And I'm Kevin Barenblatt, and we're the co-founders of Fast Forward. Thank you so much for joining us. Actually, we're here because of your support. Your support gives us the best job in the world. We get to spend our days supporting these amazing entrepreneurs. And our hope is that today you become inspired and get to celebrate them with us. The idea for Fast Forward grew from our desire to see more technology applied to our biggest social problems. We built a tech accelerator to scale solutions to these problems more quickly.
Over the last 9 years, 70 teams have graduated from our accelerator. They have gone on to raise over $350 million in follow-on funding, and most importantly, impact over 100 million lives. The pandemic has accelerated many things, and tech for good is one of them. While the problems we face are greater than ever before, so too is the momentum to solve social problems with tech that scales. Take, for example, Watt Time. Watt Time is an organization that went through our accelerator. We met founder Gavin McCormick just after he dropped out of his PhD program. Gavin had invented an algorithm that taught smart batteries to pull clean power from the grid. His vision is that you could have electronic vehicles and HVAC systems pull solar or wind energy as opposed to coal. Well, I'm pleased to report that this year, with the support of Fast Forward and so many of you watching, Watt Time will hit a critical milestone. Their technology will be installed in its 1 billionth device. 1 billion.
Incredible, right? The 9 founders you're about to meet are poised for that scale of impact. They all have personal experience with the problems they're solving. And through the Tech Accelerator, each organization has received a $25,000 grant, comprehensive training, and guidance from 100 mentors. Should we get started? You ready to meet the next Watt Time?
You ready?
Introducing Asylum Seeker Advocacy Project.
I'm originally from Armenia, and I applied for asylum years ago. Unfortunately, my case is still pending. Because the government failed to process the work permit in a timely manner, I had to be out of my work for 2 months. I was very scared because I worked very hard to get at this point, and all of a sudden I was losing everything. And because of that uncertainty, I didn't know when exactly I will get my work permit back. I ended up doing some research, and that's how I found the ASAP group. Asylum Seeker Advocacy Project helps asylum seekers like myself to fight for their rights in US. They helped me to navigate through this really confusing and complicated asylum system. And I hope all asylum seekers will find ASAP and get the support in a community when they need it.
Hi, my name is Nan Tran. I am the Technology Director at the Asylum Seeker Advocacy Project, or ASAP. We empower the largest community of asylum seekers in the world. I am a daughter of Vietnamese refugees. My family fled their home on a boat. After several days at sea, they were picked up by a cargo ship and dropped off in a refugee camp in Singapore. That's where I was born. Our family spent 6 years in this camp, in limbo, while waiting for decisions on our asylum case. I grew up watching the people closest to me navigate a complicated system that brought feelings of fear and isolation. It doesn't have to be this way. That's why we're building ASAP, a one-stop platform for asylum seekers. It's a digital community, a legal resource hub, and an organizing tool. We didn't set out to build a tech nonprofit. ASAP began by providing legal services and information through a private Facebook group. Before we knew it, thousands of asylum seekers were requesting to join every week. To respond to this demand, we launched a web app. If you're currently in the US, you probably live near an ASAP member. These are people who left their country seeking protection from conflict and human rights violations. Many asylum seekers wait years for their case verdict. The waiting is hard. It was for my family. Here's how ASAP helps. Take Rosie, a single mother and asylum seeker from Haiti. After becoming a member of ASAP, Rosie watched a how-to video and applied for a work permit. She got her questions answered by our legal aid help desk. She signed up for SMS alerts about pending immigration policy, and she joined our online community to connect with other asylum seekers. And Rosie is not alone. Today, ASAP serves more than 300,000 members. Our founding team are daughters of immigrants and refugees. We are immigration lawyers and software engineers committed to helping asylum seekers. Our goal is to be the go-to platform for all asylum seekers in the US. Eventually, we hope to serve the more than 82 million displaced people globally. And we need your help. We're building out a robust backend to meet high demands, multiple communication channels to meet members where they're at, and a portal where asylum seekers can obtain legal support, build community, and communicate their advocacy goals. We're asking for $5 million in funding to serve the 2 million asylum seekers in the US. Many Afghans, Haitians, and Ukrainians are currently relocating to the States. With your help, ASAP stands ready to welcome them all. I remember so vividly the moment our family landed in the United States. I was a child, wide-eyed and full of hope. I invite you to join me in bringing the same opportunity, a safer and brighter future, to so many who must uproot their lives and flee their homes in search of safety. Thank you.
I remember one time in high school, I went to the staff common room to speak to one of our professors. He asked me, "What do you want to be?" I looked at him confidently and I said, "I'm going to be a computer scientist." All I heard was laughter. I heard one of the teachers say, with a smug smile on his face, "Computer science is a man's world. You should go into something more womanly." I said to myself that I would never become a computer scientist. Fast forward to after I graduated from university, having not done computer science, I saw an ad and I decided to apply. This community is rewriting the story of many Black college women around the world who are struggling to get into opportunities for STEM. I found a safe space where I could be everything that I had dreamed of being. A safe space where people who looked like me were encouraged and empowered to understand that they could do anything that they set their mind to.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Diana Wilson, and I am on the mission to build the world's largest talent pipeline of Black women in STEM careers. As a first-generation, low-income student, I held the weight of my family's future upon my shoulders. My only hope was to obtain a six-figure career upon graduation. I had the opportunity to manifest these dreams. I got a full ride to the University of Virginia and accepted as a finance major. But I soon struggled because I was alone. I went from a star student to failing. So I dropped out of my major. Luckily for me, a community of Black women lifted me up. Their support helped me land prestigious internships and ultimately get to Google. My story shouldn't be the exception. Nearly 50% of Black women in STEM majors drop out by their sophomore year. Black women struggle at every single stage of the STEM pipeline. It is not due to a lack of capacity or desire. It's due to a lack of support. Black Sisters in STEM is clearing the path for women who look like me. I started Black Sis as an in-person training program, transforming the lives of 4,000 women from 16 countries, shifting most of them from generational poverty to high-earning careers in tech. Students like Tamisha. She dreamed of being a computer scientist, but after being mocked by her teachers, she gave up on those dreams. We helped Tamisha reignite those dreams. With hands-on learning experience through tech projects, a network of peers and role models, even a scholarship from Google. Ultimately, Tamisha got a job as an IoT researcher and is headed to Johns Hopkins in the fall for her master's in engineering. To serve the millions of students like Tamisha who are desperate and hungry for our support, we pivoted to a tech-first model. Our web-based platform reimagines our initial offerings at scale. We build networks, empowering our users to uplift one another. We deliver culturally relevant content specifically made for Black women, everything from job interview styles, to also how they can make their professional styles for their natural hair. And lastly, we curate jobs and internships in partnership with tech companies. Our platform is where students like Tamisha truly manifest their dreams. Our platform is built for us, by us. We have a big goal: to build a global network of 1 million Black women in STEM careers by 2026. Today, we invite you to stand shoulder to shoulder with us in this journey. If you believe that we should tap into the global brilliance of Black women, join us today. Thank you.
I'm the data director for Fairfight. Fairfight is a data-driven organization, collecting electoral data, strategizing, making sure that we are putting our resources where they have to be, and helping protect voter rights. Voting is very complicated, especially if you're a Black voter. There's lines, accessibility to early voting locations is not there for many people. Having to take a day off work to vote is a reality. Something has to be done, something has to be fixed. We were working a lot with testimonial data. Somebody telling us, I waited this many hours in line. But we only had testimonies, so we didn't have an aggregate. The Center for New Data is an organization that provides advanced technology and data tracking on voting waiting times. In 2020, the Center for New Data provided us with this dashboard. It's very helpful to have quantitative data that can prove that Black voters are affected disproportionately when it comes to waiting in line.
I think we can all agree. Democracy is in crisis. Voting rights are under assault. To protect the right to vote, we need to measure the right to vote. Big data can do this. When you cross the street, your phone might send your location to 5 different tech companies. This data is used to power targeted ads. But how do we use it to do more? My name is Stephen Davenport. I'm trained as a data scientist and policy researcher. I earned my PhD from the RAND Corporation, a nonpartisan think tank. I teamed up with Danny Wine, a campaign staffer and communication strategist. We founded the Center for New Data because we believe democracy needs a better data scientist. We are a nonpartisan nonprofit. We use big data to map voting wait times at polling locations across the country. In 2016, Black voters waited on average 29% longer than white voters to vote. Our data confirms eyewitness accounts and daylights systemic disparities. This work powers groups that are fighting on the front lines. These are voting rights nonprofits, advocacy organizations, litigators, and journalists. Here are examples of how our 2020 election data drove impact. During Georgia's Senate runoff, it prevented the closure of polling locations. In Iowa, it was used as evidence in a civil rights case to prove Latino voting rights disparities. It was cited in the New York Times and The Guardian. We couldn't do this work if we weren't a nonprofit. We receive free and low-cost mobile phone data, and we have best-in-class data science volunteers. Because of our low operating costs, we are able to provide these services to partners on a sliding scale. Because we are nonpartisan, people trust us on such a controversial issue. We're seeking $750,000 to roll out dashboards in states across the country to fight voter suppression in the midterm elections. We believe in the power of big data. It gave us Google Maps. It gave us Lyft. Let's use it to protect democracy. Join us to restore trust and equality in American elections. Thank you.
Before Empowr, I didn't really know what I was gonna do. I was just gonna go to the trade school, but Empowr gave me like something that I can actually look forward to. What I thought about software engineering before Empowr was, I thought like you had to be a mathematician, straight A's, you had to be like Albert Einstein. But now that changed. What the Empowr community provided for me so far was friendships in the software engineering community. I got a lot of wisdom and skills. A project I'm working on is AR kit in Swift. I'm also working on a skateboarding social media app. I hope Empowr changes the world by making it easier for Black people to get into STEM jobs.
I'm Adrian Devizin, and Empowr is based on my own story. From a young age, I was tossed aside in the education system. I was made to believe that I wasn't capable of anything. My own principal told me I was just gonna end up on the street. After dropping out of college, I was working at a call center, and I just felt like the world had given up on me, but I refused to give up on myself. I began reading programming tutorials in between calls, and soon enough, I developed my first app, and it got to be Google's top new financial app of the month. And with this motivation, I spent every night learning more about software development. Over the next 3 years, I experienced job loss, hunger, and homelessness. But then I finally got my first job. And within months, I was being flown out by big four tech companies. But when I got to these offices, I just still felt like an outsider. No one at these companies looked like me. While tech is focused on recruiting diverse talent, they're missing out on millions in untapped potential. They're missing out on those kids like me. Nearly 50% of Black students do not have access to the math and science classes necessary for higher education. Moreover, they don't have the resources and networks to obtain internships and apprenticeships. Empowr is solving this. We teach software development to underrepresented high school students. We are unlocking the engineering potential for kids of color. We utilize peer programming methodology so kids can collaborate and learn from one another. Our platform is based on the same technology used by both MIT and Stanford. And to ensure that there are no digital barriers to entry, we equip every student with a MacBook, headphones, and internet access. We are supported by our partners who help us provide our students with real-world experience. So how does our program work? Well, when Chase joined our pilot, he wasn't really sure where he wanted to go. But we could tell that he was a brilliant kid, and so we sent him a MacBook and we welcomed him into our program. And his brilliance showed. He learned to code with ease, and it wasn't long before he secured a paid high school internship. Chase is now employed as a cybersecurity engineer with one of our partners. Before Empowr, Chase's estimated salary was going to be $18,000 a year. But thanks to Empowr, within the next 3 years, Chase will have an estimated earning of $100,000 a year. We have proven that our model works. 100% of our graduating class has received job offers. Our team is created of teachers and software engineers who have worked at over 6 different tech companies and in 7 different school districts. We have all lived and experienced the problems that our students face. Empowr is looking for partners to invest in the rising Black tech workforce. Our partners provide internships and apprenticeships, and Empowr provides the professional development training for our students. Together, we can diversify tech, but more importantly, we can create an equitable future for Black youth. Thank you.
Historically, the discovery of medicines has taken place in the global north, where the infrastructure, technology platforms, and the talent exists. In Africa, the infectious disease burden is extremely high. The goal of Acelia is to focus on developing machine learning tools which are specifically geared towards implementation in low to medium income countries. Acelia does an analysis of the published clinical trial protocols, clinical trial results, and real world data so that we can provide evidence of how we can better design future clinical trials and therefore better outcomes.
Hello, I am Gemma Turon, and I co-founded the Acelia Open Source Initiative to help scientists cure the most neglected diseases. I am a molecular biologist. When you picture a lab scientist, white coat, and mixing colorful liquids, that was me. But during my PhD studies, I also had to spend a lot of time in front of the computer doing data analysis. Luckily, I had access to cutting-edge software and expertise. These technologies were key to the project's success. But tech is a privilege. Across the global south, scientists do not have access to these tools. Low-income countries produce less than 5% of the world's research. This means that their population has to rely on solutions devised elsewhere. Take malaria. A scientist working to cure malaria needs to design new molecules, test these molecules' effectiveness and side effects, and finally, evaluate them in the clinics. Artificial intelligence can speed up research and reduce the cost at every step. But AI technologies are unaffordable to scientists in the global south. This implies that although almost all malaria infections happen in Africa, malaria drugs are being developed in high-income countries. Malaria is but one example. Millions of people still die of infections every year. We created Acelia to help in-country scientists cure the diseases their own people face. With our platform, scientists can easily select and run AI models to accelerate scientific discovery. We offer a ready-to-use, no-code platform. All our tools are open source, and our users can share their data to help generate new models. We are working together to find a cure for infectious diseases. Our model is working. Our pilot in South Africa is currently serving 100 researchers, scaling their capacity to find a better malaria drug. We will partner with institutions across the global south. Together, we will implement Acelia's technology and train scientists on how to use it. Both my co-founder and I are highly trained PhD researchers. With over 10 years of experience in the field, we've published tens of papers and received awards for our work. We have also been involved in developing projects in low-income countries for the last 5 years. The pandemic has shown us that diseases have no borders, but science does. We are raising $1 million to implement Acelia in 10 new institutions across the global south in the next 2 years. The labs of today need microscopes. The labs of the future need AI. Help us equip labs in low-income countries with the tools to accelerate scientific discovery. Thank you.
यहाँ लगातार हम तीन पीढ़ियों से कृषि कर रहे हैं, यानी हमारे बुजुर्ग से लेके हमारे तक अभी निरंतर चालू है कृषि करना। कृषि करने में सबसे पहले जो उपज अपन पैदा कर रहे हैं ना, उसको बेचना सबसे बड़ी चुनौती है। यदि कहीं अपन चूक जाते हैं तो लाश में चले जाएंगे। और आपका जो चालू हुआ व्हाट्सएप से बोल भाव, तो इसके माध्यम से हमको हर दिन की, हर मार्केट की, हमारे एमपी में जितने भी मार्केट हैं, कि हम सही जगह पे और ज़्यादा लोगों से संपर्क में आके, ज़्यादा व्यापारी कांटेक्ट में आके अपने माल को बेच सकते हैं। मित्र किसानों या जो भी हैं, जितने भी किसान हैं अपने गांव से संबंधित सारे कुछ, तो उनको मोल भाव से बोलने का उद्देश्य ये है। तो अगर मोल भाव का इस्तेमाल करें और भी समृद्धि।
My name is Achint and I am co-founder of Gram Health Foundation. I grew up in Bengaluru, India's Silicon Valley. It was 2009 and tech was booming. My house had broadband internet and I had just got my first cell phone. It may not look like much, but the phone was actually pretty cool. I could use it to access the weather and latest cricket scores. But for all the progress in tech and connectivity, India was suffering. The country was in the midst of one of its worst droughts. Millions of farmers faced crop failure. Farmer debt and suicides were an everyday headline in the news. I was witnessing the data divide firsthand. It impacted me deeply. And I asked myself, why couldn't farmers get access to crop information the same way I could see the latest cricket scores? From there on out, I was committed to using technology to improving farmer livelihoods. Today, 70 million smallholder farmers in India are left behind by the data divide. But they don't have to be. Most farmers in India have access to wireless internet and mobile devices. The government already publishes big data on agriculture. Farmers just lack a link between the two. Gramhal bridges this divide. We built a WhatsApp chatbot that delivers critical information to farmers, like Chetram, a farmer in Madhya Pradesh. Using the GramHealth chatbot, Chetram can track the prices of corn. After harvest, he can use this information to negotiate a fair price with the trader. With local weather forecasts, Chetram can better plan his irrigation. Like, when it's about to rain, he can avoid pumping water or applying fertilizer that would wash away. And we don't just use public data, we go hyperlocal. We crowdsource up-to-the-minute data from our community of users. Farmers like Chetram can actually feed price data back into the platform to help fellow farmers. And we open source all of this data. We're growing through word of mouth. Since our launch 7 months ago, over 100,000 farmers have joined the GramHealth community. I am an agricultural engineer committed to improving farmer livelihoods. My co-founder, Simin, is a leader in developing solutions for the most marginalized communities. Vikas grew up in a farmer household in rural India. He went to Harvard and came back to solve the challenges he had experienced firsthand. Farmers struggle every day to feed us. They don't deserve to be left behind. We are raising $300,000 to empower 1 million farmers by the end of 2022. Data can empower millions of farmers just like Chetram. I invite you to join us. Thank you.
Stuttering affects every aspect of your life. My parents and teachers back in Bangladesh never understood stuttering. I never received help, therapy. I was scared to talk to my family, my friends, because they would constantly judge the way I spoke. My self-esteem was deeply affected. I feel I could have achieved a lot more in life if I would have received early intervention. So I'm very grateful for this platform. The impact was life-changing for me. My confidence, my knowledge, about how to manage my stuttering and stress has increased a lot. And I have also made lifelong friends. My father told me that I could never graduate from college because I stutter. But today I graduated summa cum laude from a US university.
Thank you. My name is Nathan Malapetti, and I am the founder and CEO of MySpeech. We use technology to connect people who stutter with speech therapists and each other. As you can probably tell, I am a person who stutters. Growing up, it was tough. My severe stutter drove me to avoid relationships during a very critical growth period of my life. Every day, I would practice reading Harry Potter out loud in front of the mirror for hours. And I would just cry myself to sleep just because I couldn't do something that came so naturally to everybody else. Stuttering caused me to grow anxious, depressed, and silent. With a supportive family and a lot of hard work, I was able to accept my stutter. And I'm incredibly grateful to be on a highly improbable path for a person who stutters. But my story is the exception. It's not the rule. There are millions of people out there who are going through what I went through, and I don't want to turn my back on them. Up to 170 million people around the world stutter. Speech therapy is crucial to helping people who stutter like me improve our quality of life. But speech therapy services are broken. First, there are hardly any trained therapists. Less than 0.1% of all therapists actually specialize in stuttering therapy. Second, inexpensive alternatives like group therapy and community gatherings are hard to find. It doesn't have to be this way. MySpeech breaks down these barriers. We built a digital platform connecting people who stutter with personalized resources, affordable therapists, and a community of peers. And we're building a sustainable business model from day one. Therapists pay $75 referral fees for each client connected through our marketplace. To date, we've impacted 20,000 people in 26 countries. We have seen 90% improvements in quality of life and an 80% platform retention rate. I'm thankful to be surrounded by an amazing team led largely by other people who stutter. Even President Biden, arguably the most famous person who stutters, recognized our tremendous potential. We are raising $500,000 to launch the next version of our application that provides data-driven matching recommendations. Our goal is to change the lives of 1 million people who stutter in 5 years. But I can't do this alone. I'm inviting you to join our mission. There are millions of people out there who are going through what I went through, struggling, reading to themselves in the mirror each night, and we can help them to achieve their full potential. Thank you.
I'm basically in prison forever. You really don't realize what it is until, you know, you hit it and you like, I'm never going home. I was like any other irresponsible 19-year-old that came to prison. Didn't care. Didn't much care about rehabilitation, didn't much care about nothing. And I looked around like, man, I don't want to keep doing this dumb stuff. And I'm getting older, and then I got tired of going to the hole and you know, let's do something different. Unlock Labs is a place where you can go and get coding skills, and not just coding skills. You can get job skills, camaraderie skills, people skills, and most important, it teaches you how to be a person. I've never, ever seen the internet in my entire life, but I can build a website, which is, I think is kind of awesome in itself. Unlock Labs is a lifeline to me. And it's just a very, very good place to start changing your life.
I spent 26 years in prison. Coming home, my resume would have looked something like, I have no work history, no education, no job, and no employable skill set. I'm fairly certain no employers would have been rushing to give me the job I needed to succeed. During my time in prison, I did a great deal of self-exploration. I learned about myself, about what brought me to prison, and about what brings most people to prison. Awareness, however, does not equate to successful return to society. And I'm not alone. Of the roughly 2 million individuals currently incarcerated in the United States, 94% do not have access to higher education. As a result, nearly all will return to prison. I'm Jessica Hicklin, CTO and co-founder of Unlock Labs. At Unlock Labs, we're building tech to make education and training programs accessible for people in prison. Our work is deeply personal. My co-founder, Chris, and I were sent to prison as juveniles to serve life without parole sentences. Our third co-founder, Haley, ran a prison education program for a decade. On the outside, access to high-quality education has never been more accessible. On YouTube, you can learn everything from car repair to theoretical physics. Why then are these opportunities not available in prison? The short answers are distance, infrastructure, and lack of data. Most prisons are located in very rural areas, limiting the opportunity for in-person instruction. You can't just access the internet on the inside. Tech made to prison specifications is made by for-profit companies who are not concerned with education outcomes. Existing infrastructure does not prioritize data collection. Without data, prison administrators can't prove what works, and students have no record of their accomplishments. After 25 years, Congress just reinstated Pell funding for prison to increase access to prison education. The problem is, there's no infrastructure to capitalize on this momentum. Unable to access education on the inside, Chris and I taught ourselves to code from inside the Potosi Correctional Center without the internet. We built Unlock Ed, a comprehensive education access platform designed specifically for correctional environments. Today, we partner with schools like Washington University to offer remote college course access to people in prison. Our platform tracks student progress, and that data can be used to create a record of achievement that can help inform who should be released from prison faster. We have piloted Unlock Ed in 3 prisons and are seeing tangible results that lead us to believe that my and Chris's story can be the norm, not the exception. We can capitalize on these early successes. We are raising $750,000 to expand our pilot from 3 prisons to every prison in the state of Missouri by 2023, unlocking education for 5,000 incarcerated individuals. Our plan is to scale state by state, until every inmate has access to the education they need to succeed. By doing so, we will fulfill our mission of building a better justice system from the inside out. Thank you.
Coming out is hard, but it doesn't have to be. Owning and accepting one's truth is very difficult, and that can put you in an isolating place, especially in parts of the country or the world where it's not as accepting. I'm a transgender woman. I was 18 years old, new to a big city, just had transitioned. I had no one to look for in that regard to offer me help. Worthy Mentoring is a tech nonprofit that connects LGBTQ plus mentors and mentees through a mobile app. And I am a Worthy Mentor. We have really in-depth conversations about love, life, things they're going through, things I'm going through that I think could be possibly helpful for them to know in their lives. Because this is all about giving back to our community and making our community a better place for everyone.
When I came out as gay at 21 years old, I thought the hardest part was over. After years of struggling to accept myself, I thought, finally, I can start living a happier life. I was wrong. Living in rural Louisiana, I had no queer friends to call on for support. I had so many questions. How do I come out to my friends and family? How do I find queer-affirming doctors? How do I simply find others like me? I was alone. I went right back into the closet. But I didn't stay there for long. I was determined to ensure that no other struggling queer individual suffered in isolation the way that I did. My name is Michael Edmondson. I'm the founder and CEO of Worthy Mentoring. At Worthy Mentoring, we're bringing safety, community, and friendship to the coming out and being out journey for queer individuals. Our mobile app connects the queer community for mentorship. Coming out is hard. The internet doesn't make it any easier. On one hand, you have dating apps and social media. These options can be quite predatory. On the other hand, you have crisis intervention. But not all questions are crisis moments. I'm left with endless Google searching to navigate my questions anonymously, or I have to out myself to take advantage of queer resources and programming. It shouldn't have to be this way. There are so many outlets for queer youth, but none for adults. I'm here to tell you, coming out as an adult doesn't make you magically love and accept yourself anymore. Right now, more than 18 million US adults identify as LGBTQ+. Isolation plagues this community because we aren't doing enough to truly support them. A mentor can take you from a place of isolation to relief, knowing simply, you're not alone. Our mission's also simple, to bring support, community, and friendship to the coming out and being out journey for queer individuals. Through the Worthy Mentoring app, a mentee struggling can remain anonymous and match with a vetted and verified mentor specific to their queer journey. A chat platform facilitates seamless and immediate communication between the mentor and mentee. Professional resources are circulated to both parties to empower and facilitate successful mentorship. Right now, our beta product is empowering 400 active users. We're empowering queer mentorship in every state, at all ages, and at all identities. Worthy Mentoring's founding board knows that this app is what the queer community needs. Quite frankly, this app is what I needed. It's what we all needed. Today, we're asking you to join us. We're raising $250,000 to empower 10,000 queer users by 2023. For so many, Worthy Mentoring provides their first queer friend. It's an incredible start to a beautiful life journey. Today, Worthy Mentoring and myself, we're here today to make sure no matter who you are, where you live, or how you identify, you never forget. You are worthy.
Weren't they amazing?
Our goal is to launch these teams. We hope you're inspired and want to get involved, volunteer, make connections, and donate. You can support the organizations by going to ffwd.org/demoday and making a donation.
Thank you for joining us. Thank you for supporting these teams. Together, we can build the world we so desperately need. We'll see you soon.
Bye.